So let's worry about the flyer object here on the end of the wall. Yeah, so camera turning left here on the couple. And imagine that with a fluid frame rate. I might render out an animatic tonight so that we can enjoy that with, you know, more than one frame a second type thing. It's still going to just be filament, but it's still, it'll give us an impression of how this works with more in between frames and see if there's any issues that we're going to spot. Okay, let's go and have a look at that flyer object here. I think if I can make it out, these things that are currently on the wall are all textures, so they're all part of this whole object here. And these things, I think they are surfaces, so I can select them, and if I go and make that surface invisible, then there's no more posters on the wall, but they're all just surfaces. So I'm thinking rather than doing that, I'll have an actual object, like a poster object. And I might just make that in a blender, because then I can go ahead and warp it a little bit. So perhaps we're going to start there. Let's make that happen inside Blender. If I can see if I can remember how to do this. Chris, you might need to help me out here, as my Blender knowledge is a little bit limited. But I'm thinking I can probably cobble together a poster that's on the wall. Doing it in Blender rather than doing it from a primitive and also not using a plain primitive will probably mean that it'll be relatively easy for me to go and UV map it and then, you know, do that kind of properly. I'll go and start with my friend, the default cube. I'm going to make him kind of lie on top of the grid, so GZ1. And I might go and not actually have it a plane, but make it something like a very flat cube. So he's going to have a little bit of thickness to it. And I'm going to remove the back face. So let me go into here and let's say the back face is this. So select faces and do that. Do we just do this? No, that's obviously not what we do. We do faces. There we go. And I'm doing that so that the unmapping process is going to be a lot easier. So with the rest selected, I'm going to go and say SZ, and oh no, that's not what I do. I do this as a 3D cursor. I go SZ and then I go make my man flatter. Like, if you hold down shift, then the increments in which you're doing that are going to be much smaller. So my idea is to have this kind of intersect with the wall, so that these edges here, they kind of go into the wall, just so that we don't see anything funny happening there. I'd also like to change the format, so I'm gonna go and say S and X, maybe 1.5, something like that. So that's kind of the format of the flyer I'm thinking of. And that's fairly cool. Control A and say apply all transforms so that all these values are zero. And that's already that. So if I wanted to make this guy not quite completely even, I could just introduce a bit more geometry in here, I'm thinking, by saying Control R and just adding a few of those guys in here. Oops, didn't mean to do that. Enter. Do the same here. Command R. Do that. Enter. So that's just a little bit of additional geometry here without having to... I mean, I will still subdivide it, but so that this thing doesn't look completely flat, I can now go ahead and select my faces here. I'm going to just go and grab this one and say geometry editing. Oh, sorry. Proportional editing, and just go and grab a point and just go on, you know, not completely ditch it in like that, but do something along those lines. GZ, make that come out. So just distort it a little bit, that it's not quite super perfect, which, you know, it's not. It's been on the wall there for a while. I'm kind of thinking that'd be nice. could be maybe even a placard now. I could, if I wanted to go really wild, I could introduce a bevel here so that it's kind of, that it looks more like a placard. I might do that. So G, Z. Groovy. Let's see if I can make that happen on here. Alt, select an edge. And I could just go and S, Shift, Z like that. That would kind of work, wouldn't it? It's like Jay's homemade bevel. I don't want to make this too high poly. I mean, it is just supposed to be a fly on the wall. Maybe this was a little bit too much, actually. So S, Shift, Z, and then hold down Shift and just make this come out just a tad, like that. How's that? I can see that on the wall. NFT it immediately, Brian. That's a great idea. Let's NFT it. This is great. Look at that. Look at how much I've remembered from Blender. I really don't use the program that often. So it's once you get to understand the habit of what it, how this works, it's actually pretty cool. I gotta say. Let's see if I can remember UV unwrapping. That wasn't all that difficult. It was literally UV editing, wasn't it? And say we pick faces, select all. That looks terrible. So we go, I think, and head over to UV. Smart UV project, and we say fine, and we have that. And that is pretty much exactly what I was looking for. So all this here is now going to be part of my texture map. So that's great. Once I have my flyer designed, that's where that needs to fit in. Nice. I say nice. Let's go make this stand up properly. That, so in, we can change that in Daz Studio as well. I just thought maybe we can go GR90. Is that right? Not exactly what I had expected, is it? Totally isn't. I was thinking we could just make it so that it's perfectly standing up. That was the original plan. I guess, you know, one of those things. R, like that. Let's just make it stand up properly. This is where a real modeler would have probably done it totally different. Something like that. NFT it. I love it, Brian. Stranger things have happened. Stranger things have happened. I think I'd like for the bevel here to come out a little bit more. So I might go and go in here and say just this edge here. And just go and say GY to kind of here. So just so that I have a little bit more leeway on the side, so I can go and then just stick it into the wall there. Okay, Command R just in case. Or Command A actually. All rotations and transformations. And instead of cube, I'm going to call this guy sign maybe? It's a Daz sign. Let's do that. Daz sign. There. And let's also save it. That was on here. I'll go and make a new folder for blend files. Blend files go in here, and I'll call this one the Daz sign. Save that, and I'm also going to export it as an OBJ. And just see how it works. Oh yeah, size. What's the size like? So currently it's 3 meters wide and 2 meters tall. That's perhaps a little bit larger than we had wanted it. I mean, it's a large thing, but that's really not the size I had in mind. I can always go and change that later. I could also go and tweak that here to make it just 50% of the size. Because, I mean, how big is a fly like that? Maybe we're talking 50 centimeters wide, 50, 60. Let's say 70 centimeters wide. Let's do that. Just a little bit arbitrary, just so that I can... that I can get my brain to comprehend that. Let me go and export this as an OBJ and see if we can at least use this as a holding object. Wavefront OBJ, top one. They've rewritten this whole dialogue in Blender 3.1, by the way. Very nice. I'm going to make a new folder here and call it OBJs. Daz sign, UV coordinates, normals. And we want the scale to be 100 times larger, ideally, don't we? And we want for Y to be up, and we want the selected only. Let's see if it works. See if it's NFT-able. Now I've got my dummy human right here, so I'm going to do something similar with this sign now. If I go and just make sure it lands on the zeroth frame, I'll show you why I'm going to do that in a minute. I'm going to go and say import OBJ's dash sign. And what sign is that? That is that's interesting. I don't recall having to import something with that. I'm going to just use the Daz Studio preset, which should put me right on most of these options here. Let's see. And it lands just somewhere. Whoops. I'm okay with that. Daz sign is here. I'm not even really going to look at it. I'm just going to go and import it. I'm going to save it as a scene subset, and I'm going to call it Daz sign. It's in its zero position right now, in its default orientation. And I'm just going to make myself a separate object of that. And here, this is kind of cool. If you save something as a scene file, you can go and literally unselect all these things, and so that only the Daz sign remains. So I've got that selected in the scene. So rather than going to unselect these manually, I can go and use this menu and say check only scene selected. And when I do that, everything disappears and only my Daz sign remains. I hit accept, and then it saves it as a usable scene here, as a usable set I can import. So I can remove this, and then I can go on Alt, left click and drag this out so that it just lands not in the zero position, but more here where I actually need it. And there it is. That's perfect. That's exactly where I wanted it. And now it's the correct size. I can go and put it onto the wall like I had expected. It's not smooth. Oh, sorry, it is smooth right now. I'm not entirely sure if I like that or not. But that's my sign. So that's very cool. Made in Blender. It's going to be super ugly green for now. Maybe I can find a slightly better shader for that. Something like a, you know, like a car paint shader or something. Let's see. IRA car paint. Oh yes. How about that? How about car paint red? That doesn't look good in the preview, does it? That's the ticket. Imagine this is where it now says Daz at one point. Daja, how you doing? Did you tell me more about the Corona incident there? Did you contract it from somebody? How far are you in getting through it? Or is it somebody in your family that contracted it? I'm hoping you're okay. I know that many people do get it these days, and I also hear great stories of them kind of flying through it, which is neat. I just wish you all the best. I hope it's not gonna compromise your health going forward. So kind of here somewhere. I don't exactly remember where it was that we had the camera, but it'll be something like this, something on an angle. In fact, let's go there with our camera and see what this looks like. How long will this take until it's fully animated? I'm not entirely sure. I'm hoping that by the end of the week I can start rendering. But there's a lot of stuff to be done, so I need to dress up the people. I may have to do deforce animations for them, depending on what type of clothing I use. And I might then only deforce the portions that are actually on camera, so not the whole 1200 frames, but only the frames that I need. We'll see. It's a lot of work. There's a lot of work, but it's going to look so cool once there's so many people in there that move. It's going to be great. And I'm glad I can share this whole project with you, the whole process with you. Let me go and put the camera to the last frame here. Whoops. This is where that is. Viewports top and bottom. So the top one can then be the preview of the cine camera. Yeah, that's not really in the right position there. And then the bottom one. That's going to be my fiddle viewport. So maybe it doesn't actually need to be quite that large, that dash sign. I mean, in comparison to the others, I think I'd like for that to happen though. I've kind of gotten attached to the way this works, so I'm thinking maybe I can go and have the camera slow down here a little bit and just go and either use this as an object that is part of the other things, or just go and have the camera stop kind of here. Yeah, I might do that. I'll go and have a keyframe here. That's on the DAZ sign. It needs to be on the cine camera. So for it to kind of stop here. And then I'll go and grab, you can't quite see that with my face in here. I'll go and zoom that in. I'll just remove that last keyframe. Just on the camera here. Yeah, so from here, I say frame 1200 just for now, and then I'll go and grab the camera that moves in a little bit closer. But then also turns around a little, like, you know, like maybe not even like that. No, let's not do that. Let's do that. We're seeing this come into vision, and then it just goes, and timing wise we can change that. It's fine. I like it. People are walking, we can already see Daz on the floor, on the wall there. I might even light it up. I'll see. But we're ending there for sure. If we wanted to make this portion a little bit faster or whatnot, we can do that. I like it. Le Pew, the man. I love it. That is very cool. So I'm thinking then, since we have half an hour and a bit longer, I'm eager to put something together that we can actually put on here. I like that idea, just to put a texture on here. I mean, it'll work fine the way it is now, but let me go and quickly save that. Let's do that. That'll require us to... So I have a very specific vision for this, and it requires me to make a picture that I currently don't have, but it's a product that I've recently bought from the store, and it's by Alessandro AM. He has some very cool products. He's the guy who made Look at My Hair. And he has some very cool characters as well. This one is the one I bought, and I'm so looking forward to exploring it. This is, so the snow here is a shader, but it's also a 3D figure that is on here. And this is not what I'm going to use for this, so, but this is kind of what got me interested in his product. So he makes these things, and you essentially give Daz Studio, you select the surface, so in this case it's the M, and then you tell it, or you tell the plugin, go and make something like this. He explains what it is, a convex polyhedron iso surface of that, and it just basically generates a new object that looks like this, and you add that snow shader to it that comes with the product, and it can make such amazing cool things like snow-covered trees, snow-covered ground, and these puffy things, so you can set those all up in the setting. So this is what it looks like. These are actually new pieces of geometry that are generated on top of something else, and he's, you know, my goodness, super, super cool. And so he's also made these, you know, these animals here in the snow and stuff, and he's made one, like this is all the snow here on this, that is what he's made with this plugin. And he has a figure that I thought would work really well. This guy here, Anthropomorphic Man Hippo HD for Genesis 8 male. I'd love to make a portrait out of this guy. So I bought this, but I haven't installed it and I haven't made a portrait out of that. But since this is for Genesis 8, I'm thinking this guy would make an excellent portrait with maybe a business jacket and some sunglasses, and you know, we'll see how it comes out. And that is what I'd like for there to be on that flyer, with the Daz logo and some Japanese writing next to it, like, you know, like something like this. I like the idea. It is so cool, literally, right? Do you know, and Lipu, I really appreciate how and the way you share that. That's just so cool. I love it. I think this is what we should do more often. This is what we should do more often. And it's the golden rot in the house. How's it going, rot? Welcome to something very special here that I'm currently building. I'm going to build this out more here in and with Photoshop. So first thing is I'm going to have to go and install this. Rod, how's it going today? What are you working on? Renderosity's Artist of the Year, Rod Shelley, by the way. Welcome. So he was called Man Hippo. Yeah, that's the one. Exactly. There's also the brown bear. I think I might not use him. There's so many cool things that I've bought recently, so I'm going to go and put that guy into maybe he's a character there. It's very Monday today, is it? Very, very Monday. And because I've got that one instance of Daz Studio up and running, I'll just go and open another one so that we can go and build that portrait. Rod, we're also guest streaming on the official Daz channel here on Twitch, by the way. Everyone who's watching on the Daz channel on Twitch, thank you for dropping by. Anyone and everyone who's watching on my channel, also thank you so much for dropping by. Super nice to have you all. So, the Man Hippo. Let's see. So he should be in my figures. Here he is, Man Hippo. So let's see how fast I can do this. So this is, it's now 6:30 here. Man Hippo. With no hair and with hair. Now let's go with Man Hippo with hair. See what he looks like. Sure, there's no issue with nudity here. And we'll see what kind of a cool tropical outfit we can put on him. Some house stuff, okay. Yeah, take the day off. Take some of the time off. That's always important. Here's Man Hippo. Okay, does he come with poses? Man Hippo hair. Thinking maybe we can make that a little bit, just the display a bit brighter here. Yeah, Brian, I'm looking forward to testing out that poly iso, what's it, surface thing. So he almost doesn't really need clothing, but I will give him clothing because that's kind of the joke. I'm more interested in the poses that we can give him. So let's see what I can find here in his head as expressions, because these need to be really over the top. I'm thinking, I wonder if the those are very subtle, aren't they? So we need something more with body, but kind of, you know, happy. I like the facial expression already. Let's see what's in the actual character's head. So there could be something like man hippo mouth open wide. So there are actually specific morphs for this guy in here. So that's neat. So as I said, I haven't looked at the product yet at all, so it'll be kind of a new thing for me as well. So that's just this one here, the mouth open wide. But that's cool, that's a good one, because that plus an expression, I can really see that working. And there's also Vaseem, so you can also go ah on top of that, if we ever needed him to do that. So just so that doesn't intersect here with one another, I'll see if I can go and find a nice standing pose that has his head going forward. The good thing is we don't need much of the rest of his body. Oh, let's just say we don't need to show that. Emergency room poses. Let's get inspired. Something where the guy's leaning forward, like this maybe. That could be interesting. See if it works. Good starting point. I'm gonna go do this again by holding down control though, because I don't want the position to change. So no translation. That could be a neat starting point. There's also, is that that? No, I'm not sure. Not for the hippo man. There's also this. Is that working? No, that's also not working. I think that's a good starting point. I'm thinking I can try to do something with his arms here. I find it really difficult to get some kind of pose going on this guy. And I don't really know why that's so difficult. It's just so out of proportion. It's just not a human guy, is he? Let's see what else I have. There's also the teddy. Does he have poses? Yeah, he doesn't really have poses. Undercover poses. Let's see. How's that going to work? Yeah, so poses, they're just not working on him. I don't think. So maybe I need to adjust my vision here. So none of it really looks like something I can really use for this. It's such a shame. I'd love for him to be on a poster, but I think it's not coming together the way I had envisioned it. Or is it? Basketball poses. Who'd have thought they'd work on him? Perhaps not all of them, but you know. Some of them. I love it. Well, that with the funky camera, if we just go and... and make him look more at the camera, perhaps? Let's go do that. I think we've got something. On the render settings, I'm gonna go and pick myself kind of a portrait aspect ratio. So I'm thinking it like a 2x3 portrait, just so that I can see the framing as I think it's gonna work on the flyer. Or looking at the hand, maybe I'm gonna go with something like a square. Perhaps, and then we'll just go and have his eyes look at the camera a little bit more. And then we give him that kind of happiness expression, and I think then we're good to roll. Give him some clothing, and then put him on a poster. The poor guy. When I say poor, he's not really poor, is he? Pose, head, expressions, and we'll say, like, maybe not flirting. He was like, wasn't there something like super happy? Excitement HD, kind of what we want. Excitement and happiness, both in the same morph. How's that? What are you bouncing in between, Rod? And how's the lady wife today? Hey, this is cool. This will work for a Japanese flyer. Let's give the guy... let's turn this into a camera and also save our scene here. Create new camera, active viewport. Do that with camera selected. Let's have a look at... parameters here. Focal length 150, that's not bad. That'll work. That'll work well. We're going to use a little bit of an f-stop there in a second, but I think I'd like to try some... I'm going to go lock the camera first with the transform. So all of these... oops. Lock all these properties. And then I'll say, go back to this. So it looks like we don't need to worry about him having pants, or we don't have to worry about the intersecting legs here. We're just going to give him a nice top and some accessories. See what we have in the wardrobe department. I'm kind of liking the idea of him having something along the lines of a business attire. There's also the karate GI thing. That would be nice. That's from the same bundle. Let's try that. Karate GI outfit, and that has D-Force on it as well. Let's see if we can do that. See how that fits him. And also see what D-Force makes of that. In this somewhat of an extreme pose. I like it already. I suppose before I do that, let me go and save it. We have the scene files. Do we have anything else here? I'll dedicate a whole new folder for him. How's that? Hippo. Whole scene. Hippo. V1. Thank you so much for being here, Lipu. I really appreciate your tips and tricks. Catch me tomorrow. I'm probably going to be here same time, same place, chipping away at this one token at a time until we hopefully have something nice to render by the weekend. Lovely to see you, Lipu. Have a good one. The hippo is seriously cool. I'm glad we could use him. Let's see what the what defaults makes of this. If we go just with the defaults here, just with the defaults, this may or may not work out, and this may also may or may not require tweaking. But it'd be good to see, you know, how it works. Just with the default 30 frames, that might not be nearly enough. D-Force is going to be really interesting to see if I can animate some outfits for the duration of the animation. So that might take some rendering time. So far, so good. If I have to, I can always bring it into Marvelous Designer and see if that, you know, if that has better results. Come on, Hippo. Hippo by Alessandro AM. Come on, Hippo. I would also like to see him in the business outfit, though. I gotta be honest. Him with kind of a business vest. Do you know, he might be. Why doesn't he just join, you know, as a guest appearance? Your girl's from TNA. Ah, look at that. Kaboom. But it's only his leg, so we may not have to worry too much about it. Oh, maybe we should worry. Time to worry. Karate outfit. No working. So good. Okay, thanks, D-Force. You've done quite enough. I have a feeling it's probably because of his proportions and his legs intersecting. So it's not exactly D-Force's fault. It's probably more my fault. Let me see if I can straighten that out. I mean, the top is okay, but it's not, you know, I see issues here on his jaw with the cloth sticking. So there are ways around it. The first thing that I can say is we can probably get rid of some of the leg issues by just making those a bit straighter, the legs here. Like, you know, you'd think that that would help. It's why is everything so complicated, huh? Right shin, why is the right shin locked? I'm not entirely sure. Why that is, to be honest. Yeah, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. So I would, in an ideal world, if this was working, I would go and make his legs straight. I really don't know why this is all locked. I can't tell you. Did I lock all that? I thought I only locked the camera. I don't really know. So I'd make that straight, and then I'd make his head invisible, and then I would go and simulate it again. So if I do that, then I no longer have the problem with the clothing sticking in here. There's also his hair, so I'm going to make that invisible as well. That'll take care of that. I could also try and make his legs just invisible. That's also a possibility. Or just the pants, that we don't actually simulate the pants at all. That's a possibility. Let's try that. Simulate that. See if that goes. Now we know about that expression, huh, Rod? Let's see. So we're not showing his legs, so I might as well not ask D-Force to simulate it. There's also the hair, so Hippo with his hair, that, you know, that might be tricky. I still think the business outfit is probably the more appropriate attire. Yeah, it's all about trial and error, isn't it? Yeah, Rod, massive runtime libraries. That's just happens because when you've been a content collector for so many years, that's just what happens, isn't it? Because that is what some people just admit to as well, that they actually I'm not so much a content user as I am a content collector. And I'm thinking, yeah, that's actually a very valid point. There's a lot of fun to be had in those types of things. And look at that, now we don't have the issues with him intersecting anymore. We don't have the leg issue anymore. So let's bring his hair back and his head. And his pants, it doesn't really matter about the pants. So now that I've hidden them, they weren't participating in the deforce simulation. So, you know, it's working out okay. If I could look at his camera here, at his framing, it's working out okay. And it's just the karate hippo. I think I can live with that. That's cool. I'd like to see him in this other outfit as well, though. So I'm gonna go and just make the pants and the top invisible, and just want to have a look at what he looks like in the business attire. Oh, that's also different materials here. Rad stuff. But they're all white, so I'm good. I'm thinking I might make that a little bit pink or a little bit, you know, something else, so that it doesn't quite blow out so much. But let's see, there's this one here. There's also just the t-shirt for 8.0. That might be a possibility. Suddenly, never give up. Look at that. Never give up, never surrender. I think that's also a nice t-shirt. So that would work well on him too. I think that is also deforce. So we can deforce that as well on him. That works as well. Just another option. Tactical outfit and stuff as well. That's also possible. I wonder if we just have a hat that kind of hovers over him, like, you know, we can put him down a bit and then he just has a cap or something that he wears. Business, maybe not the whole thing, just a vest maybe. And the vest, I think we also have some other materials here. So that is also deforce. I'm not sure if that's gonna get evened out. Which ones are the vests here? It could work. I think I'll leave his head alone for now. Oh no, that's not deforce. Okay, that's not deforce. So we'd have to go and use either mesh grabber, or we'd have to fix the poke through somehow differently. I don't think actually I like it so much. I think I like the karate outfit. I think that's my favorite. So let's get rid of the vest. This is another option that would have also worked, but I think now that I've seen the karate outfit, I think I like that. Let's use that. Karate. And I'll just see if I can, I'm not sure if we're gonna see the belt, you know, the belt's being cut off, that's cool. Hair. Let's see if I can have something else here. So I find like, I wanna move the camera down a bit. Just have that little bit of negative framing here, and then just have something here like a cap or a hat or something like that, because it's just over the top ridiculous. Let's see if I can find that. That's good framing. Could it be an accessory? A hat or cap. The snowman has a good cap here. A wardrobe. the snowman hat. Let's see if I can... I don't mean to fit it to him, but I think if I do this, it'll probably happen. That's actually fantastic. That's perfect. Sometimes you don't even think these things are funny until you try them. Especially if we can make these things flap. These things on the side. Can we do that? Morph? No, that's the no glasses morph for the... Oh yeah, almost. Yeah, that's perfect. It's kind of what I'm looking for already. I think I might turn that. I might try my hand at this in Blender or in Hexagon. That I just lift these things up a little bit on the sides. That I'm thinking I'd like to try that. Mesh resolution is base already, so that's perfect. So this is currently parented to the head. I'm gonna go and unparent that just so that I can make everything invisible and just leave the hat at its current position. I'm gonna go and, shall I do this in Hexagon or in Blender rather? Hexagon is kind of, let me try this in Hexagon. Hexagon is nice, so I don't have to then export files. I can literally just go and launch it. And it's almost like using the bridge in ZBrush. So you just do this, and here's your object. That's the hat. And when you're done fiddling with it, you can just go and send it back. So that's neat. And I'm thinking I'll just have the ears just go kind of flap open, as if the hat's just jumped up and now it's falling down again, and these things just, you know, just catch air. So what we do is, with our favorite selection tool, maybe the face selection, I'll go and select maybe these faces here. I'll go with soft selection. Bring down the radius a bit. I only want to affect this part here. And then this needs to be set to selection here. I want the manipulator to not be on world, because that would be facing the wrong way. I'll go with selection here and just to try my best. See how it goes. So this is, oh yeah, we need the universal manipulator here. Or literally just the rotation tool. That's easier to see. I think it's the red line that we want to influence, like almost like this, and then move it up a bit. And not quite, so the soft selection wasn't quite big enough. Let's go and do this again. This is, I think, where Blender would have the more superior selection tools. Sadly, I can't see the rotation for the blue here. Oh, there it is. That's exactly what I had in mind. That's exactly what I wanted. And I'm gonna go and do the same thing again on the bottom here. So I'll just go and select different pieces of the geometry here and just curl up the bottomy bits here. Select a few. Like so. And then we'll do the same thing on the other side. And then we've got exactly that kind of cartoony look that I was going for. The Pharaoh woman, how's it going? Long time no see indeed. No worries. Hey, it's nice that you're here. I'm just amending a hat that I am going to put on a hippo. It sounds crazy when I say it, but that is exactly what I'm doing. So let's go and do the same thing again. I think these few polygons, they worked out okay. I'm just amending a hat that I'm going to put on a hippo. Good stuff, Jay. I'm not entirely sure if we follow the full story. It's quite funky that now that I know how to do it on this, the practicing on this side means I literally could do it instantly on that side. That's kind of cool. I like that. See if I can remember the bottom part here as well. If that works. I like it. Oops. I like it. Hey, this is exactly what I wanted. And that's all I really needed to do. So I can go and say accept here, or apply even, or better yet, go out of that, just go back to object mode. And with that, we'll go and say file, send to Daz Studio. Who's hopefully going to remember that we've sent something in here, namely in here. It will ask me, would you like to create a morph? I do. And the one important thing when you go and bring something back from Hexagon is that you need to make sure you, usually like in 99% of all cases, you want to enable the reverse deformations here. So if the object wasn't in its zero position, if it had morphs and all that, then Daz Studio knows, or rather Morphloader knows, that it will have to go and calculate deltas on top of other deltas, so changes on top of other changes. And if you set that to zero, then you'll stand a chance that your morph isn't going to work. Here we go, morph created successfully. We don't see anything, but that's okay because I haven't actually turned it on yet. Ding, there we go. That's my morph. And I'd like to go and change this also to, I'll give it a label. I'll call it hat flaps up. I think that's a good name for that. And I'd like for the minimum to be zero. And that's that. Hat flaps up. What does that look like together with a hippo? It looks great. There we go. Perfect. Maybe I need to go and change the hat's rotation just a little bit. Like that. Also, I think I'm going to go and put the manipulator towards where the hat actually is. Nothing super drastic, but that might just make it easier for me to change the position. I'm thinking. I think that's good enough. That's good enough, I say. This is actually from Alessandro AM, Feral Woman. This is the product here, the Anthropomorphs Man Hippo HD for Genesis 8 male. This is by Alessandro AM. Let me go and put that link into the chat in case you want to check it out. That is here, and we're on here. Let's go and put that in the chat right now. Ding, there we go. In case you want to have a look at him, he's fantastic. He's just, it's the first time I'm trying him out, and I thought this would be ideal for a flyer that's going to go into the Japanese alley. So, oh, hang on, do we see something poking through here? Yes, I think I need to make another change. I need to make one more change here, and that's just that the outside geometry here is intruding onto the inside of the hat. I didn't see that. I can probably fix it with the geometry editor. In fact, let me do that. And so ideally I'd go back here to Hexagon, and I didn't actually see this. And I would go and just take these faces here that I just didn't see before up until now, In fact, I can't quite see them now. Probably need to select those outside here and then take them out. So it's difficult to see them. I'm not going to worry. I'm going to go and just hide them with the geometry editor. So let's just quickly do that. Oh, actually, yeah, see, I can totally see them here. So geometry editor, select that and go on tool settings. I want to do faces and I'll say all of these things here. That is not what I meant. Geometry, clear selection. I think I might just go and pick these and then grow the selection. So what I don't want is for any of these polygons to be selected. I only want for these to be selected. There's also mesh grabber. I could use mesh grabber to do this. That's another possibility. But does that have the effect that I was after? No, it doesn't. Okay, forget mesh grabber. Let's go back to the geometry editor. And I'm just going to go and grow this. Geometry selection, grow selection. And maybe one more time. Perfect. And that has now just grown the polygons here, but leaving the ones on the inside intact. And that's really what I want. So by turning this into a selection set, non-destructively, under selection sets, create from selected, I'm going to call it inner poke. I can just go and make that invisible and then the poke through is gone. That's really all I wanted to do. I'm glad I did that. Let's go back to our regular viewport. Bit of filament action. Yeah, there we go. Problem fixed. That's exactly what I wanted. Is there something else here? I think there's a tiny bit here, but I think I'm not going to worry about it. I mean, it's a picture on a flyer. We're going to be okay with that. It'll be our little secret. What's the trouble with the universal tool, Feral Woman? What if you made it more for the ears to make them closer to the head so they don't poke through? Yeah, that's also possible. You can do that as well. The manipulator you mean in here in Daz Studio or in Hexagon? Or am I already, is this like 5 minutes after you've posted the message? Yeah, I'm gonna be okay. This is gonna be nice. Let's see if we can just quickly see what that will look like in Iria with the default lighting. And then, oh yeah, I was also gonna give him a kind of a pink outfit. I didn't mean for that to be white because that's gonna be a bit, what's the word? That's probably gonna blow out a bit. So let's go see if we can make that white. Just the top here, surfaces, belt, sleeves, top trim, sleeves, base color, yeah, perfect. So if I just make that kind of a pink, like that, exactly, yes, like something like that. It doesn't have to be all that pink. Pink it and shrink it. Could be purple, could be the purple hippo. That might work. But it's not quite, maybe it's just a bit too saturated. Maybe this is kind of what I'm looking for. No, don't do that. Okay, I like this just with less saturation here, like that. You like that, exactly. So we just go and do the same thing on the top because I like the texture on there. Pick the same color and then maybe with a white trim. Who says that's not creative? Perfect. Oh, okay. Yes, you can do that in Daz Studio. Yes, it's on sometimes when you have items like hats, the manipulators often, if it's a rigged figure, then the manipulator is often at the very center of the scene, and that's not good. So if you use the bone selection tool, even though the figure might not have bones, you can just use that and use the little green, there's usually a green and a red mini marker, and if you use a green one and put that to where you want it, especially if it's in an unposed position, then yeah, the manipulator changes that way. It's kind of the way of changing the origin point. Yes, it's a neat tool. It's this thing here, the joint editor tool that does that. I only use this. I'm gonna leave this white. That's nice. Let's pick some cool light. In fact, let's also save my guy here. Oversave him. That is really nice. I like this. Let's go use some of my favorite lights by Kig One. Oh, they're actually on the render settings. And my favorites are these ones, the Pop Edition. And since it's going to be a Japanese flyer, I'm thinking one of these might work really well. And it also comes with a funky, there we go, perfect, funky background. That is what I want. This is exactly what I wanted. My goodness. I can't believe it. Goody. I might just make it a little less bright so I have... I can tone it up or down in Photoshop. So I'll make the environment intensity kind of 0.7. And just to make it a bit moodier. Karate. And one other thing I want to do, even though we're not going to see it at all on the flyer, I'm going to use a little bit of depth of field. So that's really easy to set up in actually texture shaded in this case. On the camera, parameters, camera, depth of field. And since we're already pretty good on the focal length, we're also good on the focal distance. Let's put that on the eyes, make that 16. Oop, yep, 16, sorry. Kelly, how are you feeling COVID-wise? Are you doing okay? Daja also had COVID. Or she was in isolation, so... Aren't they just, Chris? Absolutely. And they are so, so cheap to pick up, the ones that are... All her work is quite impressive. I mean, she's a professional promo artist for Daz, so that's seriously, seriously cool. I'm hoping we can have her on a stream, but she's extremely busy and she's a bit camera shy, she said. But if that possibility arises, I'd love to talk to her about lighting. That'd be so good. Camera, check. Iray, check, and see how depth of field's treating us today. And then we'll render this out, put it onto that fly. Yeah, look, see, this is, it just adds that little bit of extra stuff to it, doesn't it? Maybe we're a little too shallow. Maybe I'm going to go with 22 just because I like to have his snout in focus as well. For the NFT release, you understand? Little vignette, a bit more color correction, and we're good. Okay, this is cool. I like this. I'll save him and I'll render him out. And he doesn't really have to be all that big. I think 2000 by 2000 is probably ample. Then I'll use 1000 iterations and I'll use the denoiser with it, and that's really all I'll do. It'll only take a few minutes, and then we can finish off that flyer. I'd really like to have that in the scene. The Blux Fly is here. How's it going? Only a slight cough left. Okay, wow. How did you get it? I mean, congrats on surviving, and congrats on not just surviving cancer, but also now surviving COVID. That is quite crazy. that, and I hear so more, many more of these stories that people just go and get it. Do you remember how you got it? Can you track it down? Did you say your son gave it to you? Oh, I see, poke through. Oh, that's weird. I didn't see that before. We need to go fix that. These would be really easy to fix in Photoshop, but since we've not even gone halfway through the render, let's just go expand the whole suit a little bit. We're okay. Hippo Man by Alessandro AM. This is still, it's a tiny bit out of focus here, but I'm okay with it. It's, you know, I'm good with it. I'm good with it. Let's just have a look. So yeah, there's no such things here. I'll go and select the top, and under parameters, under actor, under adjustment, do we see anything like expand? What's it? Expand, there are no expand morphs. Damn. What a shame. Suppose controls, no, those are hidden properties. I'm gonna go and just set those to off. Lower, upper, front, buttocks, hips, and there's so many. I'm not gonna go through them, especially because I don't see them in the preview here. Do I see them in texture shaded? Just as a, just checking. No, I see they're also not there in texture shaded. I'm gonna go and have a look at the smoothing modifier here. I think we have mesh resolution is here. Mesh smoothing is also here. Smoothing iterations, I might just go and crank that up to 10. Let Daz Studio render a little bit longer. No, actually now they're coming through. So they were set to 5. I'm gonna go and see if I can increase the collision iterations to 10. Still working on it. And ten is a lot, so you know. let Daz Studio have a go at this. Maybe we can just go and fix it itself. If that doesn't work, I'll just have to go and look really closely and just hide those bits and pieces there. No problem. I might do, Feral Woman. I might do. See you soon. Hey, it's just good to see you. Always good to see you. Music's over, by the way. Let's bring it back. Yeah, so 10 might have been too much. Clearly. Could it be that my the viewport and the rendering, they may not have been set to the same subdivision surface iterations? That may explain why I haven't seen it in the render. Let me go and switch this back to just the defaults here and have a look under mesh resolution. Yeah, this is actually render and subd in the viewport is set to the same. So if I set this to 0, then I can kind of see where these things are creeping in. So I could go ahead and hide the surfaces on the hippo. I could do that. Ideally, I would just go and increase everything about the top. Scale doesn't really work in this case. And another ideal way is, so ideally we would actually see this. So this is a good way to, like, you can either do this in Hexagon, or you can go and do this in ZBrush fairly easily. I would love it if we could just find a way to do this, to make this happen in all inside Daz Studio without having to worry about it. So 5 on the smoothing iterations did this. Collision iterations, if I increase that, it still isn't really doing an awesome job. I think that's because the figure is just so you know, it's just not designed for this karate suit. So let me go and do this in ZBrush then, with it switched to smoothing iterations to the defaults, and then I'll go with the with the sub D level of 0, and then we can, once we bring that in, it'll hopefully still work as well. So I think this was set to 1, and it's still not great. So I'm going to go and set this back to 0 so that I know where the problematic zones are, and then I'll just go and drag these things out in ZBrush. It's only going to take a minute. I think the hexagon we're done with. Not going to say if it's good. A push, oh, that's a possibility. Chris, that is not a bad idea. Let me do that. A push modifier, that is a very good idea. Is in there. Edit, object, geometry, add push modifier. Chris has solved the problem. It's the one-click solution, the push modifier. And even on sub D1, we're not worrying about the belt. That's okay, even though I think we have a morph for that. Don't we? Adjustment, belt. Belt back. No, that's that. It's belt, adjust front, like that. That's also that sorted. Chris, 1,000 points to you. Thank you, buddy. That is exactly what we needed, and we're probably okay now with mesh smoothing on the defaults. Chris gets 1,000 points. I'm gonna go and save the scene again here before we go and render that. Do you know, it becomes more and more clear to me that doing 3D is very much something that requires more than one operator brain at a given time. It's not, you can't have one person operate 5 different applications and expect everything to work. You have to have multiple brains working on this problem at all times. I'm thinking. There! Problem solved, Chris. Fantastic. I love that. That is just so cool. I find that fantastic. That's just so cool. This is my favorite way of doing things. We're all just chipping in. You should try this. Hey, yes, that was the solution. Chris, I'm excited that you're going to join us for an official DAZ stream, where we're gonna discuss how. So Chris, in case you didn't know this, and I'm gonna give you a shout out to your channel. That's your reward here, there we go. Chris regularly streams over here on Twitch on his own channel, and Chris builds outfits in Marvelous Designer, or Clo rather, and builds them so that they can be used inside of DAZ Studio. And he does this not just with Marvelous Designer or with Clo, but also with Blender as well as Substance Painter. So there's a whole process that you can learn there. Chris currently doesn't sell on the DAZ store, but he has a store on Renderosity, and he also has a Ko-fi page where you can buy him a coffee. You get to ask him questions in the stream. You can subscribe to his channel, and it's always awesome to hang out with him and all our cronies, really. It's just wonderful to hang out and see little projects come together. So yes, that is what Chris does, and in so doing, he's kind of a bit of an expert when it comes to adding defaults to an object that doesn't natively have it. So if you think about an outfit that's being made in Blender or in Marvelous Designer or in ZBrush, it's basically a static OBJ. It has no rigging on it, it has nothing else on it. And so Chris can and does frequently go ahead and turn this into a defaults capable outfit. And it's a fairly complex process, but you know, like so many things, once you've done it 400 times, it really grows on you. And so Chris is good at it, and he's going to show us how this works. I'm very much looking forward to that. I'm going to go and just save this on my desktop, because he's going to be part of a hippo path does not exist. Yeah, that's a good point, actually. I'm going to just leave it on the desktop. Did I just say that? Desktop. Desktop. There we go. And then we'll take it from there. Hippo V1. There. We've saved that scene. That's cool. Let's go back into the Photoshop, where we're going to go and use you as a template. And then we'll have you. That is going to be another nice picture for my collection. The hippo. I'm actually thinking of starting this flyer inside Canva. So that's another neat thing to use for anything like, you know, poster, thumbnail creation. Yeah, so like this. Whoops. Then we don't need Minto anymore. And I think maybe this is also very difficult to see for me right now. So it's going to be something like that. And he will have something like a drop shadow on here. Stroke actually as well. Stroke, not so much in yellow, but in something like a white, so that we have it, that he looks, that this looks a bit like a Polaroid. I'll make it on the center here, and also like maybe 22 is a good number. And then we'll go and also add a drop shadow to this. Maybe a wee bit larger, like, you know, 25, no, maybe not 2,500, 25 was probably enough. There we go. Perfect. And now, so for this to actually end up on my, in a neat way on my object, I'm going to go and make this a little bigger here. And it's not going to stay in this format, so the format's going to be determined by the actual UV template that I'll give it. So this is just a little mock-up here. Oops. Just make the whole thing a little, give me a bit more edge here. The other thing I've been meaning to do was grab out some of the Japanese words, and I'm thinking I can probably use these posters here for that from the original scene, because I'll just keep it in line with what we have here. So if I go and select this, I can go into the Surfaces tab on the editor here, so JA decals, and there's a whole file in here that is just full of Japanese stuff. So this is what I'm going to grab out. I don't know what any of this means. Please do let me know if this is anything like, if you know, it's words that we shouldn't be saying, but I'll just grab some of these things out, like especially the red thing here. Let me just go and see where that is. It's in my DAZ library in textures, Melee 3D, JA decals. Gotcha. I'm going to go and open one of those. As we see them a little bit larger, those of you who do speak Japanese, please do let me know. Please do let me know what that says. Public documents, DAZ3D in snow. That's not it. My DAZ3D library. Runtime, textures. Melee 3D. JA. They're large. Decals, all right, perfect. Well, there's two. Diffuse 3 and 4. Oh, great, so we have two. That's perfect. Let's open both of them. All right. No Litter, Minato City. These look great. And I like the idea that, please don't show them any food. That is probably directed to cats, Roberta, you know? This would be ideal because I can take the white out. It's so funny, isn't it? Japanese whiskey, single malt. Yochi, is that like scotch? Coffee grain whiskey, all right. I do like. Yeah, those are ideal for keying. I think I'm attracted to something like this here. I think that would work really well. Do you remember there used to be, what was it called? There's the Cheeseburger Network. ICANN has Cheeseburger, and they had a site that was called English Funny, and those were extremely hilarious translations. I always enjoyed those. That made me just, they made me laugh so much. It's crazy. So a couple of these, I think maybe this one and that one. And then of course the DAZ logo, and we also need a texture for the underground so that this looks, doesn't look so flat. So let's start by cutting some of these up here. I'll duplicate this into a new document. And I think maybe these two would be okay. I think maybe this one here, this one, I'm interested in this bit here where it says, you know, it has all these things at the, whoops, at the bottom, crop tool. Yeah, there's a bit of a shadow in the way here. Maybe I'm not going to use it. I gather it's somehow about DVDs and PS2 games and stuff. Now we can get away with it. It's just going to be for a small inset. Like so, we crank up the saturation a little bit here. Oops. No, not the time. Yeah, I suppose curves would be ideal for this. We do curves underneath it, and then we can do, there. And we're okay with the shadow. I'm okay with that. I think, yeah, that's already good. So there's this. Then from here, we'll go and grab the top thing here, the red one. Crop all the black stuff out so that we're just left with red. And then I might even go and add something new red underneath it. Oh, come on, there, like so. Yeah, that might be nice. And then we'll have a solid color, kind of a red underneath here. And then we'll make this a bit bigger, like oops. And this, I suppose, would be better suited to a tablet. Do I have one connected here? I don't know if I have. Dude. Huh. Oh, flow, yes, good point. Trying to blend in the edges here. Amateurishly, have I got a tablet? I think I do. All I need to do is balance it somehow on my lap. That's what it is it? The 24-hour game store. That's exactly what we need. Bluxfire, I bought yesterday, I bought Hellblade. Have you played that? I was really attracted to the to the character models. I thought that was seriously exciting. That just want to even this out a little. Doesn't have to be a masterpiece or anything, but just to make this kind of blend in a bit better. So that we have our own 24-hour DAZ store. Hellblade and... Yes, absolutely. It looks... I've just seen some footage and I thought, wow, it was just over $6 yesterday. And I thought, man. I mean, just... It's not really a game as such. It's more like a... And it's not a... It's a title that I would traditionally not exactly go for. But it's more like a... Like an interactive experience, I'd say. But yeah, Hellblade, very cool. The main character looks unbelievable. Bit of a scary story, but you know, we can look at it together. It's gonna be really, really cool. And then the other one I've picked up yesterday was Horizon Zero Dawn, the PlayStation game, but for PC. I've heard really good things about it. It's also not really my type of game, but I thought, hey, why not? If that'll work. Should I remove the pink here? The pink and maybe or some of the darkish glow around here. I might remove that as well. Probably select this with a color, just get the pink out. That might actually work better. Like the color range. Dude, where is it? Well, that's everything gone now, isn't it? That's not what I wanted. This is probably because I don't exactly know how to use it. I thought we're just gonna go pick a color, like, you know, this pink here, that it's not actually picking up. And then we're gonna go and make the thing select that. Oh, it's because I was on the mask. Duh. So color range. Right, yes, select that, please. Right, and with that, I can go to the mask and then go and take that out. But I thought, hey, this is just too complicated. I think I'm gonna go and I just brush it out. With the smaller brush. A skilled Photoshop artist would just do this in 2 seconds flat with just taking the pink out, you know? but there's always more things you could learn, you could do. Color selecting the letters. Yeah, actually, you know, that's even a better idea. Just color select the letters. Don't worry about the background. Just replace the background full stop. Do you know, that's not a bad call either, Luxify. That's actually, that was probably the most sensible solution now that I think about it. Why don't we try that? Why don't we try that? I mean, it's no issue trying that. I'm going to go and delete that and remove the mask. Delete the layer mask. There we go. So if we were to go and just select the letters. Good idea. Also by color range, you think? Do that by color range? Using masks all this time. Yeah, absolutely. Let's try color range for this and just pick this. Mess with fuzziness. Hasn't quite caught everything. We can also add multiple colors to it, so you can have this and then you select multiple and more things here. Yeah, but like that. I mean, we're totally getting there. That's the selection. So now if I go and mask this off, then we're left with this. And, you know, Bluxify wins $1,000. There we go. Not bucks, points. Sorry. That's not what I meant to say. But there we go. Much, much easier. Much, much easier. And result, much more pleasing on the eye. This is all, you know, still not quite there. Bluxify, you're the man. Thank you so much. Awesome. And then the other thing I can do is now I can just go and blend this in a little bit so that it goes and, you know, has its own thing here. I can also go and just add a bit of color correction on this. Just on that though. There. Bluxify. That's the one. Okay, perfect. So that is one Japanese sign. Then this one here we're actually okay with. There was one other thing I was thinking of using, and that's just this one here. Shadow, also a good idea. Why don't we? While we're at it, right? While we're at it. Oops. Interesting. But it didn't do that. Well, it's not the size, it's the... It is the... Is it the distance? My goodness. 5 works. 10 does not. Go figure. 8. 8 also doesn't work. Duh. Glow outline, something like that. I think we're good here. I think we're good. This is a little bit of a shadow. That's already doing us a bit of a favor here. That's okay. And then there's that. So this here, that was also nice. I don't know what that says though. So if anyone can read this, do please let me know. I'll zoom in on this now. It's this one here. And it already comes with a little border here, so I don't think I need to do anything about that. I'll call this JA1, and then this one is here JA2. I'm also going to go and flatten the image here. And then we have JA3. And this, I think I might also go and just flatten the whole image. Nope. Dude, seriously. Flatten image, and this is going to be JA3. Could be the mask, yeah, it could be. Sometimes Photoshop is a little funny about these things. Oh, actually, was that a good idea, flattening the image? Maybe it wasn't, because then if I leave it separate, I'll just go get rid of that. And if I leave it separate, then I can use the background red on this as well. I might try that. Let me try that. So I'll put this into a group. And I'll go and duplicate that into my, what was it called again now? It was this, wasn't it? Yeah, so this one, we don't need that anymore. This one here, let me go and save that. Also on our Japanese Ali folder, I'll make another folder in that that's called PSDs. My goodness, look at how long we've gone on for, because it's just, you know, there's always something to do. This is going to be the DAZ sign. So this whole thing duplicate into the DAZ sign. And let's see if we can find, yeah, perfect. Find uses for that. This guy goes on the top of that. And then I have this all separated, so I don't have to use this anymore or that anymore. And then this here can go literally, yeah, look at that, this is perfect. And then this can be our background for that. We don't need that anymore. Then we have this. I don't know if I'm going to use it, but it's another decal in the house. And then we have this. And then, of course, one thing that we haven't got currently is the actual DAZ logo in there. So that's gonna happen as well. So I'm tempted to put this. Upside down. Oops. Yeah, so something like this, you know, something along those lines. I don't really know if I'm going to use this or not, but you know, this and that for sure, and this one is something exciting. Something exciting will come of it, I'm sure. And we're gonna, I'm thinking of a texture and then kind of the DAZ logo in here, and we'll expand the background as we see fit. Let me just bring that in and put that all together. And then tomorrow we can maybe go and bring this all into the scene and start dressing up people and, you know, set lights. That's my plan. Let me go and see if I can find that DAZ logo. bit of a drop shadow, possibly a glow. Maybe actually liked it in white, and then we can just go and lower the opacity as we see fit. Maybe also a stroke that could also that might work. Makes it look like a bit of a neon light, I'm thinking. Yeah, I have a feeling it might benefit from it being, you know, also red by itself. Maybe it doesn't. Maybe it just gets lost, the effect, then. I'll leave it white. Something like that. Well, let's see how this works up on... Yes, exactly. I'm going to actually call it a day today. I think I might go and... No, actually, I won't. Let me go and just grab my texture template out of Blender and just put this on there as a preview, just so I get an impression of what this is going to look like in the scene. I'm kind of interested in that. Let's do that. So we have... That was in Blender. I should have really exported that. The UV template. Then we can just have a quick look what that's gonna look like. This guy, we're done with him. Here's the Blender. Greased file. Daz Scene. So in UV editing, or with Daz Scene selected here like this. How do I... Do I even need to bring this out? Well, that's fine, what do you think? I mean, it's a fairly... The aspect ratio matches fairly accurately. I think I might just be able to wing it by not doing this. I might just be able to say export as JPEG. I think not even that. I think Daz Studio can work with the PSD file. So if I don't want to do that, I can just literally put the whole PSD file on that. That might be a little bit of an overhead, but you know, it'll work. Actually, let me do that. That's even better. Daz Studio accepts PSD files. This guy, base channel. So it has car paint color on there now. That might not look great. I might go and put the regular Daz Uber shader on there. With the surface selected, obviously. It hasn't actually reset the materials, duh. Selected and replace overall everything. It still hasn't done that. So if I go and browse to this now, this is going to have this ugly red overlay here. But let's see. It's PSD goes on there, multi-layered. It's not a problem. All I need to do now is just make sure it lines up properly. Maybe it'll even retain some of the funky car colors there. Who knows? So let's turn this white first of all, and then there's the glossy orange color here. I might also turn that white. So we don't have that overlay. So now then it's only a matter of playing around with the tiling here, I suppose. Well, but it's not rotated properly, so I would need to do that. Can I do that inside Daz Studio without taking it out? What do you think? Rod, thank you for dropping by. Always good to see you. See you again tomorrow, same time, same place. Is that something I can do? Inside Daz Studio? Angle, is that it? No, that's not it. It's got to be under geometry somewhere. Is this it? No, that's not it. That's the... There's vertical offset, but that is just where it is. And there's the horizontal offset, but I don't think there's a rotational value in there, is there? We could just, so that we can use this without having to do any UV mapping whatsoever, we could just go and rotate the map inside Blender. That is possible. So that is, that's as easy as that. And then we just go and make sure it fits on the island here. It keeps doing that. That's uncool. I wonder if there's probably an automation for this, where it just says pack. Wasn't I just there a minute ago? As my brain stops working. Right, that's what I'm, exactly. It should center perfectly, right? Let's have a look. You're saying, you're so welcome, Daja. No problem. Hit N, let me do this. So the N, and then under, I've got Packmaster as well, so that works, but like this one here, 0.5 and 0.5, you say? Did that do the trick? I didn't see it moving. It's fairly centered already, isn't it? Blocks 5, what do you think? Did I do this correctly? I don't think I have. It's just the image. Yes, it just goes... Pack just does this. It's RX90 that does that. And you said... How about 0 and 0? Should that not work? That also doesn't work. Right side of the tab image. Oh, I see. I'm so sorry. So you mean this here. Right side of the tab image. That's not it either. Blender is so confusing. There, centered. Boom, I've done it. I don't know how else to do it. I'll just leave it like that. I'll just export another OBJ and I will call it. Oh, that's it. Okay, perfect. Sometimes, you know, I'll call it Daz Scene. Rotated UVs. And I'm going to scale this to 100 again, and it's selected only, and that's really all I want to do. So the thing now, whoops, the thing that I can do now, which is just so cool, and this is another trick I've learned from Chris. So I've already got my sign in a position. I don't necessarily want to import the whole thing again. All I need is another UV set for this. And this is where the master Chris has had another, just a very helpful tip a while ago. He says just import the UVs that you've made as a second UV set on this object, and then it'll be rotated. So I think that worked with the object selected under Object Geometry. and then I don't remember. Where was that, Chris? You totally know what I mean. Importing another UV set. Load UV set, that's the one. Object geometry, load UV set. Pick the next object. Go clunk, and what you want to call it, rotated UVs. So the object stays the same, in the same position, and where I selected now, I don't exactly remember. Was it under general, maybe? Was it under base? I'll just search for UV set, and there's UV map, UV sets default. Oh my, and we have our rotated UVs here. Oh my, is this exciting or what? They're sadly rotated the wrong way, which is somewhat of a shame, but even that I can fix. So I can either go back into Blender and do that again, or I can just go and fix that here on the tiling by going horizontal offset. No, that's not horizontal, it's vertical. I thought that's it, vertical, and go into minus one, and then it'll be the kind of the kind of rotated. I just need to have that also minus one, and then it's that way up again. That'll work. Now I can go and squish it and squash it anyway, any which way I like. It's a nasty way of doing it, but hey, it works. Isn't that cool? I find these things seriously exciting. So I didn't have to properly UV map the object, which is just or the object upside down. I could have done that as well. Yeah, I'll just do it all on the UV, on the UVs. Until it just about works out. And since this is the PSD file, the cool thing is, as I make changes to that, it'll just, Daz Studio is just gonna take these things in as well. So I'm good on that front. So I can put a vignette on there. I can add the texture on there. I can do all kinds of other things on there. So I'll work on that. But I think for now, I think we've done quite a lot, I have to say. Now, as I animate this, this sign stays in place. I like that. Let's have a look at the whole animation up until now before I save the final scene. So we can go come back tomorrow and see a little bit of our handiwork here. First 100 frames, we're going to go and ignore them. Awesome stuff. This is nice. This is going to look really, really cool once this is finished. Got the arguing couple. Got the guy sitting. Yeah, we're gonna talk about you, buddy. We've got her walking. There's nobody hovering either. There's people walking by in the background. One person, two people, and, you know, even three people. Isn't that cool? And we've got this super exciting shiny sign here that I might give a little bit of a backlight glow as the camera goes into here, and it just integrates really well into the whole wall there. I think I might go and make sure that the camera kind of logarithmically goes further to the sign. So I think it was just a bit linear and abrupt, so we're going to go and fix that path. But hey, not bad, I gotta say. I'm excited. This is gonna take a serious amount of render power. I'll see if I can get in touch with the friendly people from Infinite Compute. Right, Daja? I'm thinking that as well. I'm gonna go and render this out as an animatic. Yeah, here, so this camera move here, I just wanna do something about that. I'm not entirely happy with that. So it's literally just it coming up from here. It kind of pauses there and then it goes into here. I think that's nice. But this one keyframe here, if we change that to TCB, oh, that does that again. Yes, we've changed that earlier. That's the one that that Lepru said we should change, but we can probably, so that this doesn't happen from here to there, maybe when we go and change this one here to TCB, like this one, second one. Let's see if that does the trick. So I changed them to linear, like all of them. If I make the second one TCB, let's see what that's going to be like. So then the first one is still linear, but the second one hopefully then logarithmically goes in and does something funky. Is that good, or is that terrible now? I can't tell. It's a bit too fast, but that's also relatively easy to fix, isn't it? Or is it? I think maybe it's gonna actually be okay. I think I'm gonna be okay with that. Even if it's a bit rushed, I mean, you know, could be rather comical to go, what have we found here? I always struggle with getting these timings absolutely super accurate. I think maybe the second keyframe here just needs to be, we just need to give this portion a little more time. So if I go and just copy this keyframe here, put that further to the back here, maybe even further here. And then I'll go delete this. What could possibly go wrong? We'll find out soon. So maybe halfway there. It isn't. It's my favorite thing once it's all in place and it all works. Yeah, okay, cool. So we're gonna go and just make that. Put this in here essentially. So paste that here. Hello? This is also where literally the hours just go by and by, don't they? I'm okay with this. If this is the speed at which we're arriving there, I'm okay with that. And the final keyframe, I might put that back so that we have literally two or three more seconds that just where this, not so much this, I'm okay with that. Like from here to here, I might go and make that a little bit longer, like elongate that for 2 seconds or so. Just make the animation like 1400 frames or so. And then we're good. Yeah, cool. I like it. My friends, thank you so much for being here and checking out this working session. I'll very much likely be back tomorrow at around 4-5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, probably 5 p.m. And Chris is on tomorrow at 7 p.m. So I'll be on before him, and then we can go ahead and raid him on his own channel. It'll be my pleasure and my privilege to do this animation with you, and I always appreciate all the funky little suggestions that you guys have and all the little tips and tricks that I can pick up and that we can pick up from one another. Thank you so much. I will see you hopefully tomorrow. Have a wonderful evening and take care. Bye-bye.